Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. It has started with a truly spectacular array of colors. What a beautiful day it is. It's still a little bit chilly. It's 22 degrees centigrade, which is 72 degrees Fahrenheit. But it's my favorite time to be out and about in the bush. Good morning, my name is Jamie, and I have Tebs on camera with me this morning. And Viam and James are out and about on foot, so we've got lots of exciting things planned. Without further ado, because we did just have to stop for the sunrise, we're going to carry on and we're going to follow up on those alarm calls. So Lynn and Diane both sent through information that the monkeys and the guinea fowl were alarm calling at the dam lot this morning. I also heard them while I was having my coffee in DRC. And generally, that combination of alarm calls, guinea fowl and Franklin, means one of two things. One is a leopard, the other one is a bird of prey. That time of morning, my guess would be either a leopard or a Barrow's eagle owl. We know that the Barrows live around that drainage line, so they could well be there. Keep your eyes peeled because Karula did come back into Djuma sometime yesterday. Let me know if you spot anything on the Djuma Dam camera while we check out the back and around to the Gallagher waterhole. See if we can spy whatever was disturbing those creatures. And don't forget that it is a live safari, so we never know what we're going to expect. You can also send through your questions to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email them through to questions@wildearth.tv. And Lynn, you wanted to know if there was a leopard, would the hippo be disturbed, would it get out of the water? And the answer is probably not. In fact, it might even chase the leopard away just by charging it while still in the water. We know that happened with, which leopard was that? I think it was Mvula a couple of weeks ago, where he tried to get down to the pan for a drink and Pete the pond hippo kept trying to disturb him, chase him away. Hippos don't really feel any kind of threat from leopards, especially something small like Karula. Wonder where she would go from there. That's definitely why I need your eyes and ears on the dam camera as well as our drive, to see if she comes across in that direction. She loves this drainage line in this particular block. And it's a good place to be if you're a leopard at the moment, because it's essentially the only water source on Djuma. That's why I want to go and double check up around that pan. Useful to actually. Oh, and already lots of screenshots of our incredible sunrise. I think it's going to be, I don't know, I'm trying to figure out what's going to happen with the weather today. We rushed home yesterday and we put the rain covers on in this desperate, vain hope that it was going to rain last night, which it did not do one drop. Entirely false alarm. Morning, buffalo. Oh, who's sleeping there? It's a breeding herd. Yes. Hello. Believe it or not, there is one very small breeding herd tucked away in there. Let me try and find a nice gap. Hiding away in here. They know where the leopard is. I mean, seeing these small... Oh, now I hear a go-away bird. Seeing these small split herds of breeding buffalo, I think that's most likely to do with this drought and with the weather we've been experiencing. Because moving together in a huge herd means that everybody's not going to get enough access to food. I mean, if we look at the grass, or any kind of grass, anything on the ground, there's barely anything left. So for bulk grazers such as buffalo, This is a very tough time, so it makes sense that they've fractured off into these small groups. And they will have spent the night sheltered here. Quite a nice protected spot. What's up, go away bird? Doesn't sound like a frantic alarm call to me though. For new viewers, I'm listening to that sound that's going wah. I think in this particular case, it's just the early morning dawn chorus. All of the birds are particularly vocal at this time of day. And now, I want to get a move on. Not that I want to leave these buffalo, but I really want to go and just double check that Karula's not going to pop out somewhere around the pan. We can always come back to this herd at some point in the future once they're up and about, but I do want to go and just double check to see that Karula's not moving through the drainage line. Somebody got poked in the side.
Buffalo. James Hendry, VM of course, is on camera, packed up like a pack mule of old. He's carrying a large pack, and VM and I, of course, are not enormous human beings, so it's quite a trial for him. We'll see how far he can walk. Last time he walked 3 hours without a breath, so that was pretty impressive. Today, equally impressive, in fact possibly more so, is the incredible sunrise we have coming up through the east there, and I'm just going to stand on this termite mound and hopefully the sun will peep up over the horizon in the next few seconds. Of course, this walk is just as live as the drive is, and so you're welcome to talk to us. In fact, it is encouraged, and indeed enthusiastically so. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to ask us a question on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you want to ask us a question on the email. The objective of the bushwalk, for those of you who perhaps are not regular viewers, is to see, just get a bit sort of close and personal with the bush, with the wilderness, to see what we can find in terms of small things, birds and tracks and trees and spiders and that sort of thing. And if we do come across tracks of a large animal, well then that's great, and that'll be a bonus. We'll try and follow those. If we come across some elephants or some buffalo, we'll try and view them on foot. Even better still, a cat. It's not going to be focused upon finding large animals. We'll be looking at the detail of the bush more probably than we will the large stuff. That's it. We'll just see what happens as we go along. Now I'm going to stand here because I think that sun is about to peep over the eastern horizon. Laura, very nice questions. We wait for the sun to pop up. You're saying you've got a saying where you live that a red sky in the morning, sailor's warning. And you said typically if there's a red sky in the morning, you'll have snow and sleet. Not so much here. I've heard the term red sky in the morning, shepherd's warning. Red sky at night, shepherd's delight. We don't have a lot of shepherds around here, about the same number of sailors as we have. But I've also not found that to be ever true. It wasn't a red morning so much as it was a pink one this morning. And of course, with the drought progressing as it is, I seriously doubt whether there's going to be anything in the form of precipitation as we go towards the middle of the day. That said, it's supposed to be cloudy the whole day, which will be a merciful relief from the beating sun. And just as that beautiful sun does pop over the horizon, you can see it coming now. It's been amazing to notice how, although it hasn't been as hot, there it comes, there it is. Though it hasn't been as hot over the last few days as it was in the week leading up to Christmas, certainly the lack of water and the lack of expectation, the lack of cloud in the sky has made it feel that much more kind of, I don't want to say oppressive, but slightly oppressive. The monkey's alarm calling. And squirrels. Vim, should we go and see what's making the noise? Okay. There's some squirrels and monkeys alarm calling down just between the dam and where the final control is. Let's go that way. Come with me quickly, everybody. And we'll just ask the final control to tell Jamie as well, because I think it might be worth her coming to this area to have a quick look. So we're basically heading straight towards between where we live. There are two spots to live, one there and one over there. And we've got monkeys now alarm calling down in the drainage line below the Djuma Dam cam. So if you are watching the Djuma Dam cam, please keep an eye on that. See what you can find. That Nyala that I'm looking at there, I think would be substantially more panicked. It's running now because it's seen us, but it would be alarm calling if it had seen a predator. The monkeys have also stopped. Let's just keep going down through here. Another thing we want to keep an eye out for as we approach the dam, of course, is Peter the hippopotamus. Do not want to come across the hippopotamus out of the water. So when you're approaching water at this time of the day, you've got to keep a real close eye out. So Jamie's just down by the dam. Apparently she's got some go-away birds alarm calling, so she'll follow up there. We'll head towards that area, looking for tracks as we go. I don't see any tracks here. There, the beautiful sun, while we stand and just have another listen. You've got to be so patient when you're doing this stuff because, well, your ears are the most valuable thing you can have during a little hunt like this. That's the hardy-dar ibis calling. There's another Nyala there. That squirrel is still going crazy. All right, let's get across to Jamie. She's just over in that direction over there. Let's go and find out what she's hearing and seeing, and I'll carry on looking around here.
What we're doing at the moment is now investigating in the drainage line around where we thought we heard the alarm calls. Now, James said he could hear monkeys as well as squirrels. I could only hear go-away birds from where I was. Which is why I want to double check around here and then head towards James's direction and see if we can consolidate a little better as to where we were hearing our sounds. But keep your eyes peeled because this is a leopard's favorite spot. Just checking up in the blackberry. I did do a quick loop around the pan, there's nothing there. Get a little bit tricky. So Safari Dean, you were wondering about the difference between an alarm call versus a bird's normal call, and in some it's really, really obvious. It's very clear what it is you're listening to. For example, with guinea fowl, that make a very harsh purr sound as opposed to their usual whistle. Let's get ourselves safely ensconced in the sand there. at, where you're shouting at it. Gets more tricky when you've got something like a go-away bird. That alarm calls sound very similar to its normal call. You have to just listen to the degree of how frantic it sounds, and then whether or not there are others responding. Now the big herd of buffalo is now heading up to the dam that we saw this morning. So they're up and about. Find James just to let him know that there's a herd of buffalo on his way to him as well. Now yesterday we were incredibly fortunate in the time that we spent with the wild dogs. We had the investing pack with us almost the entire afternoon. And both Monkey Man and Jenny, you were wondering if the wild dogs have left us. They have for now. They crossed right at the end, sort of towards the last half an hour of the sunset safari. They cut through and across down south towards Chitwa. I'm not sure if the other guides managed to follow up there. I did tell them that they were heading in that direction. But of course, that's outside of our traverse area. Buffalo, but they were looking well fed yesterday afternoon. You never know, they might have come back towards our area. I wanted to follow up on the alarm calls first before checking Gowrie Main. No sign that everything's gone very quiet. Buffs. Well, we head up and out of the dam and have a look at these buffs drinking. Let's go across to James, who has a worm to show you.
There is a little inchworm, everybody, aka a caterpillar, that will turn into a moth, hopefully one day, if it gets through this stage of its life. It's not the only thing we're looking at, though. I can't identify exactly what kind of moth it is. But Vim is also looking at something else. And that's the same herd of buffalo that Jamie watched to start with. There's a cow that's spotted us. The rest of them haven't. She looks like she spotted us, but now she's turned away. And Jamie is just below the drainage line there, below the dam, just looking around there. That's where we heard the monkeys alarm calling. The buffalo, of course, what we want to do when we view big game on foot like this is to make sure that they don't see us, or ideally, if they do see us, that they don't react in any way that would change their behavior unduly, because they'll see us as a bit of a threat. Now, that's the same little herd of buffalo that we saw yesterday evening, and it's the smallest herd of buffalo I've ever seen in this area. Why it should only be about 40 strong, I'm not sure, but let's just sneak up to the termite mound here and have it. We're just going to sit on the termite mound and watch the buffalo. We'll use the cover of the mound as we go so that they can't actually see us coming. We wouldn't really want to approach them in the open because that will make them nervous. And so we'll just kind of go around the termite mound here and then we can stand here and watch them. They've definitely seen us now, so let's watch how they react. And check the wind. So the wind is good for us at the moment. It's blowing from them to us. And even though they can see us standing where we are now, and the fact that they can't smell us seems to make a huge difference. They don't like the smell of human being. Dave, very nice question from you. Why do I carry a stick? Dave, simply for effect, basically. I like to be able to point at things. You need to be able to discipline the cameraman every so often. That's just quite nice. I like to have something in my hands. That's the only reason. It definitely doesn't have any kind of a security reason attached to it. Brent carries an enormous club, but that's because he's more like a caveman than I am. I suppose I shouldn't say that. He is on leave at the moment. He can't defend himself from the other vehicle. All right, we're going to stay here with these buff. Let's try and climb up onto the top of this mound here. Where we can get a good, try and get a 360 degree view of what's going on here. And B. Wilson, while I sit here and rest my aging back, you say, you can see how dry it is from where we are. Absolutely, B. It is so dry. You can see tufts of stuff and sprigs of vegetation. The colour is all wrong for this time of year. It should be a lot greener than this. Those buffalo are watching us, but as yet they haven't smelt us, and so they're not panicked at all. Now, the trick is going to be to spot Peter from up here. You do not want to be just approaching the water like this. Now, if there is a leopard around here, and this is around about where we heard the monkeys alarm calling, then what the leopard will do, I think the hippo is in there, yeah? What the leopard will do is wait. If he wants to have a drink or she wants to have a drink, the hippo's in the pan there. The hippo will, at least the leopard, will wait until the buffalo kind of moved off, because they won't really tolerate the presence of a large predator, us included. So let's just sit here quietly. There are still squirrels alarm calling like crazy off towards the camp there. And even if it's Karula that they're alarm calling at, she is very happy to spend time basically in Vuyatela camp. She finds it restful. Here comes a little baby impala running. Where its mother is, who knows? This is interesting. Just watch it. That's very strange. Matt, very nice question. You want to know what precautions we take when we're on foot versus being in the car. There go the buffalo. I think one or two of them are a bit nervous of us. Now, Matt, while we're watching these buffalo, this is a very interesting point that you bring up. You want to know if we take any special precautions. The special precautions that a human being has to take involve using its brain. Our brains are our most effective form of weapon out here. We are very careful. We listen a huge amount, obviously. We look a huge amount. We smell, and we stop often to look what's going on, especially if we're tracking something like this. And then if you happen to be viewing a big animal like we are, the buffalo, you watch their behavior very carefully, see what they're doing, see how they react to you. They've definitely seen us. Going to ask them to put the camera on them. They're a little bit worried, and if they come any closer than that, we're going to move down off this mound and get out of the way, just simply because they might want to come and investigate us. If there was a predator like a lion here, you'd find one or two of the males or the females, big females, would come and look. They'd almost come to say, guys, I've seen you, now back off and go away. What you don't want to get is a situation where they're investigating you and you're stuck on a termite mound and surrounded by them. So the trick would be here just to use the cover. If they came any closer than they are now, we just go down the back of the mound and disappear off through the cover. We probably did quite quickly, but at the moment I'm pretty comfortable with where they are. And the thing is, once they've seen you, what you don't want to then do is behave like a lion or a leopard or any other predator, and that would be to hide. So So if they turn towards us any more than they are now, then we're going to move out. Now, while we're watching these buffalo watch us, and we're almost at the point of backing off here. Crystal, you want to know about whether or not I enjoy the sunrise or sunset safaris more. Crystal, at the moment the sunrise safaris by far, because they're warmer, at least cooler. And the sunset safaris starting at 4 o'clock in the afternoon are very hot indeed. I love the sunset, so the last hour of the sunset safari is fantastic for me. But the sunrise safari is just so beautiful to come out in the early dawn light, smell the fresh smells of the morning, enjoy the sunrise, enjoy the cool. It's so nice having a bit of cool air blowing over the landscape at the moment. So I find the sunrise safari more enjoyable. In winter, maybe not so much. In winter, it's very chilly, of course. And the sunset safaris in winter, you get an amazing sunset. And the middle of the day is just beautiful, deep blue kind of winter skies versus the kind of bleach stuff that we're getting at the moment. So the monkeys have stopped alarm calling now. And no, Janet, you want to know if monkeys would alarm call that herd of buffalo? No, they wouldn't, Janet. They wouldn't alarm call at all at the buffalo. They would be more than happy to let the buffalo drink and then move off. They only alarm call at animals that are a potential threat to them. And the herd of buffalo is simply not a threat to monkeys. A leopard, on the other hand, is. Now, there's one bull buffalo at the back of the herd there that is looking up towards where we heard those monkeys alarm calling and towards where the squirrels are alarm calling. Very nice question from Declan. You're 11 years old. Right, so you're watching the buffalo there. They're exactly away from us. Now, watch the ash bag. You want to know what this is for. I don't know if you can see. Can you see anything puffing out of it? So what it does, Declan, is it shows me which way the wind is blowing. There we go. So it shows me, even on a still morning like this, there is a breeze. So, for Viam and I, it's very difficult for us to tell which way the wind is moving because we're not that sensitive to it. So we shake the ash bag and it blows from the buffalo to us, which is a good thing. It shows that the buffalo won't be able to smell us. They can see us. They're all watching us now. But what it means is that no animal can smell us from behind the wind. They'd be able to smell us if they were the other side, and they would react differently. Animals don't like to smell us, and especially if you're tracking something like an elephant or perhaps even lions or buffalo, you want to be very constantly aware of where the wind is blowing, because even if they can't see you, animals like that, very sensitive noses, they will smell us. And so you have to be conscious of which way the wind is blowing all the time. There they are, they're still watching us. It is just very interesting to sit and see what's happening here. Why were those monkeys alarm calling? What made them call out? Why do they only call once? They also, like the squirrels, have got exceptional vision. They'll be able to see something like a leopard from a good distance away. So if it was far away, they might give one or two and then stop. That was my monkey alarm call. Did you like it, Jim? It was brilliant. Thank you very much. All right, let's go across to Jamie. I think Viam and I are probably going to extricate ourselves out of the situation so the buffalo don't see us anymore. And we'll make our way sort of gently around into that drainage line area below Vuyatela camp and see what we can find there. See you shortly.
Although there's no sign of any leopards around the drainage line that we were here. hearing those alarm calls from. I'm still certain it was a leopard that all of the animals were shouting at. And we've just picked up some tracks that are moving up here. Aubrey is just ahead of me. He has called them in further up the road. So we're going to start racing up in that direction. Now, a leopard, when it's on a mission, when it really wants to move, it could easily have been the same leopard that covered this ground while we were circling around the dam. It was moving up and to the north along Boyatena main access. So there's a chance that that is what the animals were alarm calling at. Might have pulled a very sneaky maneuver on us and sort of slid past both James and myself and continued on up the road. One of those things that sort of becomes almost like guesswork. You don't know that for certain. The monkeys and the various birds and the squirrels could well have been alarm calling at a bird of prey. Unlikely though, it's just too many coincidences sort of racking up together. At this time of the morning, on a nice cool overcast morning, leopards across the Sabi Sands are going to be out and about, patrolling territories and hunting. It's the perfect time of day. It's very cool. Just trying to get an idea whether I'm tracking a male or a female. Chill would like to know whether or how often we see leopard tortoises. And the answer is, this time of year, fairly often. Not as often as we would like to, because it has been so dry. Tortoises do struggle during the dry season. This is their breeding time. Usually with normal rains, we should be seeing them pretty much every single day, wandering about and looking for mating opportunities. It's the time of year when tortoises mate. See them at least once a week, probably about twice a week. You're more likely to see them on the walks, just because you're closer to the ground, you're more aware of what's going on at your feet. And as soon as the rains come, that is when tortoises really start to move around. So if we do get any drizzle, ha ha, we wish, if we do manage to get any rain, then you've got a really, really good chance of seeing both leopard tortoises, and then the other one that we do see fairly regularly is a hinge tortoise, so a hingeback tortoise. The leopard tortoise is definitely the most common. It's the most widely distributed within South Africa as well. The tracks cut through here and north into this block. Now, having tracked leopards through here before, I know that they follow a fairly regular path, or they usually follow a fairly regular path, unless it's Karula, in which case she takes her own directions through the bush. But they usually pop out around Sandy Patch. So that is where we're going to head. We're going to see if she's come out of that open patch there. It's a female that we're tracking. I thought I heard a squirrel alarm calling, but I think it might be a false alarm. Oh, Sharon, you wondered about me talking to the animals. No, of course, I know they don't understand what it is that I'm saying. They definitely don't. But I do believe that the tone of voice calms them. And I always use a very similar tone, just quite a low rather than a high-pitched sound. Mostly I find it's the most effective with elephants, and I'm not the only person who does that. I know of lots and lots of people who swear by talking to elephants. It's just a way of keeping them calm. And I know for certain that they recognize changes in your tone, because sometimes you just have to shift ever so slightly. If they show any kind of signs of aggression or are overly curious, you just have to make a little bit more of a sharp tone to your voice, and they immediately stop what they're doing. For the rest of the animals, I think they get tone. I do it a lot when I'm walking as well. If I'm out and about on foot and I know that the animals see me, then quite often I do what's known as presenting myself. So just talking in a normal tone of voice so that the animal knows that I've seen them, I acknowledge that they've seen me, and that I'm not trying to sneak up on them or pose any kind of threat. For the cats and the predators, I don't think it has any kind of actual impact on them. It's more for my own purposes. I find it quite entertaining to continue my own little dialogue with them. Leopards pop out if they move through this block. I've also, just to continue on the subject of speaking to animals, I've had one or two incidents with elephants at night, particularly in the area I used to work in, where they really, really didn't appreciate the presence of any kind of cars. Here the tracks have come out. Tracks have popped out here, moving up this road. And I've actually sung to elephants before, when they've been unhappy around my car, not enjoyed my car lights. Found that works quite well as well. I'm not sure whether it just made me feel better or whether it actually had an impact on the elephants themselves. Road heading towards Sydney's dam. There is a creature up ahead of us that would have let us know almost immediately if a leopard was moving through where she could see it. Yes, good morning. There you go, I'm talking to the animal again. Have you seen a leopard by any chance, girl? If she knows, she's not telling us. Now, the kudus are one of the best ways of, or one of the best alarm calls to follow, because kudu are very particular about what they alarm call at. It's either a leopard or a lion if you hear a kudu barking. And for those of you who haven't heard it before, it is the most phenomenal sound. It's a deep, low bark that carries the furthest distance than any other antelope. They've got the loudest bark of any creature out here. Look too stressed out. Hey, so Snoopy Cool, who's our new viewer, or our newest viewer for today. I'm really glad that you are enjoying it. Yes, it is live. Comes with its own set of magical moments and challenges. Makes it totally unpredictable, but it's the most incredible experience, and in my opinion, the best way to learn about the world out here, because we can't script anything. The animals do the scripting, and we just have to follow along and take our cue from them. Hey, big girl. Thank you. can see those huge radar ears constantly on alert. And she does seem a little bit nervous, and it could be because a leopard has moved through here. She might even have just caught a whiff of it as it passed through, especially if the leopard's marking its territory. And we started our morning with a search around the water holes to see if the leopard had moved through there. We were listening to all of the alarm calls. Now Alison, who is 10 years old and watching our show, he wants to know how often do leopards need to drink water. Interestingly, leopards are not nearly as water dependent as some of the other animals out here, but they do like to drink. So if there's fresh water available, they'll drink every day, particularly after a salty meal. So if they've eaten an antelope, they might go and try and find some water. So if water's available to them, they will drink as often as possible. But they can go for easily a week without drinking. They're adapted to get a lot of moisture out of their food. They've got very cleverly well-adapted kidneys that utilize and are very, very effective at filtering through and making their urine highly, highly concentrated. It's one of the things that gives their urine that strong popcorn-y smell. And that is why, Alison, that leopards are so adaptable to different environments. That's why we get them here. You sometimes find them in cities, and you can even find them in desert areas where water access is incredibly scarce. Phenomenally clever animals in terms of the way that they're adapted. And there are stories of people finding leopards in old abandoned buildings in cities in Johannesburg to this day. And it's one of the reasons why organizations like Panthera, which is a big organization that studies big cats around the world, is focused at the moment at determining exactly what the leopard population of South Africa is. Because truth be told, we have rough ideas in areas like the Sabi Sands, but beyond that, we really don't know how many leopards there are around South Africa. There's another animal that would alarm call and let us know if a leopard was around here. And one tiny lamb that's been dashing about like a mad creature. Here it goes. Look at it go. Yeah. And that is just for the sheer joy of being alive. It's not frightened. The rest of the herd is perfectly relaxed, stopping to have a quick scratch. But baby wildebeest and baby impala at this time of year, they've got a lot of energy. And they bounce around like that. And of course, that's play. But as we know, play both in human forms, in sort of for children playing, as well as for the little predators like leopard cubs and lion cubs, that play purpose actually serves a really interesting function because it helps to build up the muscles and the strength and their agility so that if one day if they really need to use it, they have that coordination, which is why that little impala lamb leaping over the various obstacles and the logs around it means that it's practicing skills it could well need in later life. Finished with the game though now, and already feeding on solid food. So there you go, Andre, who's watching in Florida. You wanted to know what age they start to feed on solid matter. And these impala were born, what was it, about a month ago, and already they are supplementing their diet. Now this little one is probably still suckling from mom, but in the next month or so it will be almost completely weaned. And it's one of the reasons that impala have evolved and stayed the same for pretty much the last few 100,000 years. They are so well adapted towards survival. Their little babies grow up incredibly quickly. They're born perfect miniatures of the adults. And by not suckling on mom for too long, it means that they don't deplete her energy reserves. are already self-sufficient, and we notice it a lot with little impala babies, that they move off from their mothers after only about a week or so and start to live in creches or in nursery groups. Here we go. It might even go and suckle now from mum. Definitely going to try. So Andre, although it is feeding, it's still supplementing its diet with mom's milk. Now I'm going to go through a bit of a tricky signal patch on my search for this leopard. In the meantime, let's head back to James so that he can show you a nest he's found.
Here is a little nest. Now we've come into an area round about where we thought the monkeys could have been alarm calling. Haven't seen a monkey, haven't seen anything else. We did hear, interestingly, the sound of, if you imagine if you've ever had a domestic dog, and I'm sure most of you would have, if you've ever heard a domestic dog lick its chops or kind of open and close its mouth, that kind of meaty sound is what we heard exactly where we're standing now. We haven't seen anything. There was a lot of hyena activity in the area, so maybe it was a hyena, maybe it was a leopard, I'm not sure. Let's just have a look at this nest while we're looking. I don't know what built this nest. It's the second one I've seen, and I'm suspecting that it's something like an apalis, and I'm going to check on my bird app shortly. The squirrel alarming. These squirrels around the camp are deeply irksome. I think they lie a great deal. They cry hyena quite a lot. Let's just keep listening, but come and look at the entrance to this nest here. You can see it's a brilliant nest. There's a sort of hidden entrance there. There's nothing in it now, and they've very cleverly woven a leaf into the door flap. You see that? That leaf is a door flap. Watch this. And there you can see inside the nest. Isn't that clever? There's nothing in the bottom of it. But I think this is an apalis. Now what I'm going to do, while we're just going to silently stand here, and I'm going to look around. I'm going to find the apalis. There's the squirrel. Beastly squirrel on the ground there. What I'm going to do is open up the bird app and show you the apalis, and that's what I think this is. Simply by the size, it's so tiny, and I don't want to walk around here too much and frighten off whatever is shouting. Let's see. Food breeding monogamous nest, an upright oval structure with a side top entrance, built of mosses and plant fibers and usually concealed in a leafy branch. That's exactly what that is. That's an apalis. And there, let me just find which apalis it is. I'm pretty sure it's the bar-throated or the yellow-breasted. There you go. That's an apalis there. Yellow-breasted apalis or bar-throated. Could be either. There are so many little squirrels shouting in this piece of bush here, but not huge, you know, they're not really excited. If they see a leopard walking past, they'll make a much louder noise. And that growl you heard was my stomach. Yeah. Isn't that nice? Amazing little nest there. All right, we're going to continue walking very slowly through this area. Suggest we go. In fact, there's a termite mound behind us. We'll go down past that termite mound and see if there isn't something the other side watching us carefully. A leopard, a hyena, and then we'll go up into the drainage line areas there. There are four drainage lines that join along there, and the hyena den is on one of them. Now, while we're walking along, one of the most common questions we get, of course, is about the dangers that we face out here. And Dave, your question is much more valid often than the question of what large game might potentially flatten us at some stage. What venomous insects are there out here? Dave, there are no venomous insects. I mean, there are a couple that can blister your skin, so a blister beetle, but they're very obviously coloured, so it's unlikely that a blister beetle will get you without you noticing. Then standard issue wasps, of course, hornets, they might sting you. Again, unless you were severely allergic, not particularly something you have to watch out for. The thing that you need to watch out for, Dave, of course, are ticks. And ticks are not insects, they're arachnids. I'm just listening as we walk very slowly around here. And arachnids, Dave, like ticks, can give you something called tick bite fever. I'm not sure where you're from, Dave, but it's certainly nothing like as tick bite fever is nothing like as bad as, say, Lyme's disease, which you get in the States. So that's not a particularly terrible thing. I mean, obviously the most nasty insect out here is a Anopheles mosquito, which can give you malaria, but this time of the day, not so much. So Dave, no, nothing particularly hazardous on the insect front out here. And yes, Billy, to a certain extent it's possible. Billy, you want to know if the squirrels could be alarm calling at the humans in the area. They could be if we were sort of approaching them and trying to get up into a tree. They don't really see us as a predator though out here. And especially, you know, where we were standing here and then suddenly a squirrel alarm calls and it's looking off to the side. They've got exceptional vision, so they could be seeing a spider, not a spider, they could be seeing a snake, they could be seeing a small sparrowhawk, you know, be a little bird that size, that could pose a threat to them. So, no, I don't think it's the humans, but a good question. Right, I think we must carry on now down through here. I'm not sure what that sort of jaw-snapping sound was. Could have been a bird flying off. We did see a nightjar which has very large wings just after that, and it could have been that flap of the nightjar's wings against its side. We only heard it once. It's so funny, you know, you walk through an area like this wondering what on earth there could be here, and you walk slowly and you don't realize how you're getting quite tense, and then suddenly you realize that there isn't anything here, and you realize how tense you've become as you've snuck around in the bush expecting to find a hyena or something around every bush. Eric, you are getting hold of us from a secret fishing hole. Well, sounds very exotic. You want to know about osprey, and do we get them here? Not in this region. We do get osprey in South Africa though, especially in northern Natal, wetter areas. Osprey do migrate down into South Africa. But I've never seen an osprey here. I think you'll find in very wet years, there will be some parts of the Kruger where you could possibly see an osprey. You've spent a long time with Kruger. Have you ever seen an osprey here? No. Yeah. Maybe in the deep south, in a very wet year, you might find an osprey. But certainly not around here. They'd get very hungry, especially during the drought. All right, let's just keep moving through here gently. Enjoy your fishing trip, Eric. I'm not much of a fisherman myself. I feel it's a gap in my education. Brent Lear Smith, of course, is one of the world's most enthusiastic fishermen. Sorry, Vian, you're going to get a bit stuck there. And he is currently in Zimbabwe, or he's going to Zimbabwe with Andrew, where they are going to fish in Kariba Dam. I suspect Andrew will lie on his back for most of the time, but Leo Smith, given the fact that he has... Oh, careful. Liam is now very stuck in a gwari bush. There we go. Leo Smith will not be able to sit still for more than 10 minutes. So on the back end of a cold Zambezi lager, I think he'll be fishing for most of the next 2 weeks. Right, the Gallagher waterhole is just down here. So we'll walk down past that and then up into that wonderful drainage line system, one of my favorite parts of this reserve to walk. such a pleasure having the cloud cover. I say that whenever there's cloud cover, but I do really mean it. So you can see very thick bush through here, and I know a lot of questions about security are asked. We do walk very carefully, and in thick bush like this, your ears are your most valuable weapon. And with the cameramen, I quite like it if they don't. Sometimes they'd like to monitor sound, so they'll wear those cans on their ears, and I think it's much better just to have their ears open so that they too can act as security detail. Lots of buffalo tracks here, let me show you. If you look here, you can see some buffalo tracks. And while we look at those buffalo tracks, Lissa, you want to know if VM carries snacks on his bushwalk? No, he doesn't. You don't, do you, VM? You don't have a snack, or have you got a chocolate bar in your pocket?
But they melt.
Oh, they melt. You see, all the snacks melt. He can't, he's got no cup holder where he can bring his giant mug of Milo slash coffee, which is a sort of hot chocolate coffee mocha mix. No bananas, no apples. So by the end of it, I mean, he looks like an emaciated refugee after 3 hours on foot. Come on, VM. Stout fellow. Be brave. We'll be back for breakfast before you know it. It's such a nice variation to be on foot, you know. We do get to know this reserve extremely well while we're driving around, and it's important to get a more intimate experience of it. Alina, a very nice question, and it's a very very valid one for this time of year. I'm just going to get through here. You want to know how often do large mammals come into conflict, like hippo and buffalo and elephant? Alina, more and more as it dries out, not so much when there's enough water, but a bit like with human beings, if there's sufficient resources, we tend not to fight with each other. But as the drought continues, and as the water becomes more concentrated, so the animals will come into more and more conflict over water. So yesterday, we actually had a fairly peaceful interaction, but, you know, it was a fairly, there was some pretty stringent activity at the Djuma Dam camp down the other side there. There was a hippo in the water. There were three buffalo bulls sleeping in the water. There was a breeding herd, that same breeding herd that we saw earlier this morning, came to have a drink. A large breeding herd of elephants came to drink out of the same, sorry, there is just quite a lot of alarming bird activity. And squirrels and babblers. But they're just not that upset. I'm going to suspect a snake or a small sparrowhawk. So we had all of those animals and some impala and a wildebeest lurking around that same water. And they actually got on with each other quite well. The hippo initially, a few weeks ago, was trying to chase everything away. Eventually the buffalo negotiated their way into the water such that yesterday evening there was one basically lying on the hippo's nose. So this water, there's nothing at the moment, and of course animals other than buffalo won't spend an enormous time around water because they do need to be careful of being catched by something, but caught by a predator. And if the longer they spend around the water, the more predictable their behavior becomes. Now, if you're enormous like a buffalo bull or a hippo, that doesn't make an enormous difference. But if you're say an impala or a duiker or a small antelope, you don't want to be around the water too long. You want to drink your fill and then melt away into the bush. Okay, nothing drinking here. We're going to push on into the drainage system. Like I say, four drainage lines. 1, 2, 3, 4. They all feed into the big drainage line that feeds the Djuma Dam, which in turn feeds into the Morawati drainage line, which in turn feeds into a much larger river. I don't think it goes all the way into the Sand River. I think it joins another tributary of the Sand Rivers. Right, that's it from us for the next little while. Let's go and see Jamie, see what she's up to, and I'm going to head into the drainage lines and we'll catch up with you once we're there.
And hiding away and playing very camera shy is a Swainson's spurfowl. Now, we hate to drag you away from James, but this is a bird that we don't... I certainly haven't seen all that often on Djuma. I know that they are around, but that bright red face is incredibly distinctive in both the males and the females. So for those of you who are working on bird lists, or for new viewers, I would encourage you to keep a bird list of the birds that you see out here, because we do get some really incredible and beautiful bird species. And this is one of them. So it's a Swainson's, S-W-A-I-N-S-O-N-S, Swainson's spurfowl. Being very camera shy. I was hoping, it is one of them, it is related to the crested Franklins. So one of those birds that is on constantly high alert. It might give us some guidance as to whether or not this leopard has hopped out of its blockade. That's a bird I want to get on camera. Let's see if we can do this. I'm going to make Tim's life very difficult. There is a little black and white bird. Oh, no, never mind, it's just gone. Nope, no way. I was going to try and show you all a chin spot battis. One of those beautiful but shy little birds. And unusual in the sense that the female is actually more brightly colored than the male, which is very, very unusual. Oh, there's some more interesting birds up ahead. I hope they keep doing what they're doing. Birds while they're doing their display. Now, local cultures, that display of rocking backwards and forwards and laughing or calling while they do has led to local beliefs that local comparisons with cackling old ladies. All rocking up and down. Those are green wood hoopoes. And gone. Really awesome birds. They're actually, when you do see them, they've got the most incredible shiny green shimmer to their feathers, and then beautiful black and white stripes underneath their tail. I've always known them as a red-billed wood hoopoe. Very recently they've started changing all of the names of the birds as a way of creating some consistency. Vanished. A way of creating some consistency across the world, where you get different bird species all being called by the same name. And we've actually come straight into the middle of a bird feeding party. There's a crested barbet. That big stump. Oh, the joys of a live safari. It just flew away. There's a whole load of Cape glossy starlings. They look like a couple of long-billed crombecks. All of these birds are very, very tricky to get on camera because they're small and very speedy. But bird feeding parties is what happens when they all group together. You spotted him there, Tibbs. Well done. Come on, come out. For new viewers working on your bird list, this is a very common one that we get. But sometimes rather uncooperative. That was a crested barbet that we were trying to show you. Also a very striking bird. Chatted about new viewers and ambient sunshine. You were wondering where it is we are, or what our location is. We are on Djuma and Arathusa game reserves. That is where we operate within the Sabi Sands, which falls part of the Greater Kruger area. So the north, part of the northeastern corner of South Africa, one of the most incredible wilderness areas, definitely the biggest one within South Africa itself. 3 million hectares, so 3 million football fields of untouched wilderness landscape that we're fortunate enough to move about on. And we have our own little segment of it. And today, everything is playing really camera shy because there are a couple of dwarf mongoose in here as well, which is one of my favorite little creatures, the smallest predator that we have on the reserve. They promptly run away. I just want to check some tracks here. Nope, our leopard still hasn't popped out. This is the most difficult of all of the tracking lights. When it's overcast like this, as soon as it gets to about 6 o'clock, becomes really, really tricky because the sun's not catching the tracks and creating shadows. And leopards, I think the best description in terms of tracking leopards came from Steph, who suggested that it is a little bit like following tissue paper blowing across the ground. It does just mean that I have to keep checking rather thoroughly. Now if you are Brent sized, so 6'4", looking over that side of the vehicle is much easier than if you are my size, or dare I say James's size, since we're roughly on equal footing in that respect. Which is why I keep swerving the car off to the left to check that side of the vehicle for tracks. About birds and the various bird species that you can encounter here. I mean, we've easily got well over 300 birds that you could see during the summer months. One that is incredibly common around the world is the pied crow. And Balma, you were wondering if I've ever seen one on Djuma. Once. Happened once. Now, usually you see them, it's fairly common for you to not see them in game reserves, because they are quite heavily in competition with other bird species. But you'll see them in the sort of surrounding townships and surrounding roads where they pick off bits of roadkill. But I've seen one once on Djuma. It was at the time, for regular viewers, when the... What have we got here? This is interesting. Oh, this is so cool. No, stay, 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 please stay, please stay, please stay, please stay. They're all around this tree. Let's get a good shot of them before they disappear off. What have we got? I think we've got a whole collection of Amur falcons. That was really cool before they all flew away. There's very few falcon species or little bird of prey species that are as sociable as the Amur falcons, A-M-U-R. They tend to get together and hunt in groups, and I think I'm fairly certain, although I didn't get the clearest view before they flew away. That was so cool. Wait, hold on a second. Sorry, Balma, I'll get back to your question in a moment. I really want to see if we can get another view of these birds. There they are, they're sitting on the top of that dead tree. Oh no, don't go. There's still some sitting there too. I know it is right into the light, so I'm making Tebs's life very difficult. Let me show you what they look like. And the reason I'm saying it's a mirror falcons, having only seen them very briefly, is just because of the social nature of that particular bird. So we're looking at number three here, which is these birds. Tiny, tiny, tiny little birds of prey. And with a slight sexual dimorphism. So that's the male on the left, and then the female on the right with a whiter face. And they roost communally in trees. So it's very interesting to see them. Awesome. Really, really cool. That's a first for me on Djuma. And it might be a first for some of our more regular viewers as well. So add it to your bird lists. Really interesting stuff. But back to Velma's question. Velma, you were wondering whether I'd ever seen a crow. Yes. When the Birmingham boys chased the Nkrumahs off a buffalo kill in the drainage line off Twin Dams, they decided not to finish the carcass. They weren't actually that hungry. And there were about 60 vultures clustered around it. And in between these vultures, there was one poor little pied crow desperately trying to dive bomb its way in between the vultures and not get chased away by them. It was fascinating to see. Alright, well, that concludes our birding talk for this segment of the morning. Let's head back across to James, see what he's up. No, sorry, doesn't conclude the birding talk. There's a purple roller. And it's gonna fly. He birds, man. Shouldn't even try and put birds on live TV. Let's head across to James and see what he's up to.
So we've come to this little termite mound here in the midst of these drainage line systems, and there's a huge number of birds calling. You can hear the hyenas going there. There's some Aramark babblers behind us. Quack, 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 quack. All around us I can hear southern black tits calling. And through the drainage line is the southern boo-boo. That thing's the sticklers. Beep, 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 beep. Franklin behind us, and way in the background, you won't be able to hear it, is Ingodoto, the ground hornbill. Do 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 do. It's the male with the deep voice. Do do, and the female going. Do 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 do. The most wonderful sound. So you can see a nice view off to the west there, and a lovely kind of view of the clouds moving slowly in from the southeast. Alison, you're aged just 10 years old, and that's marvelous that you're on our little walking safari with us this morning. You want to know what a squirrel alarm call sounds like, Alison? I'm not sure where you're from in the world, but it sounds like because there's squirrels in many parts of the world, and I believe that they sound fairly similar throughout the world, but it basically goes, and it sits there going, flicks its tail like this. There you go. That's basically what a squirrel does when its alarm calls. So our plan from here is to head sort of north up towards where those hyenas were calling. I think they're calling from the den, which is not too far from here. And Susan, very nice question from Brooklyn. You're asking about whether when we're walking on foot we feel a natural part of the ecosystem. Very nice question. I think it's different for everybody. Certainly, the idea is that we become a participant far more on foot than we are just observers. And in the vehicle, we try to be an observer completely. On foot, we are much more an active participant. we are where we, it's a much more primal experience because of course we evolved here on the plains of Africa, and for us to walk through here is to almost go back to that position in the ecosystem where we are seen as the apex predator. Our brain is our greatest weapon. We are not stronger than anything out here. We are not faster than anything out here. We are not more potent in any way other than for the fact that we can think so much more effectively than any other animal that has ever lived. And that's what our main weapon is. And to walk through here with that knowledge that we are physically almost inept out here. Obviously, Viam is more apt than I am because he's carrying so much more weight. But yes, Susan, there's definitely a feeling of active participation rather than observation when you're on foot. You've got to be a lot more aware. It's a different kind of awareness. You know, Jamie's driving around now. She does a lot on foot as well. But when, so just if you were to compare Jamie and me now at this moment, she's looking around. She's her focus is on searching for animals and searching for tracks. There's a hyena. Hyena running there, walking there. That's wonderful. Well spotted, Vian. Can you still see her? Yeah, I can see her here. She's there. She's walking away from us. Oh, that's wonderful. Well spotted. I think she might be coming closer here. She was moving away and then I think she turned round. Maybe she smelt us. Nothing. Okay, no, she's gone away. Wonderful, big hyena female, possibly going towards the water. We'll go around that way and see if we can see her. So, I mean, that hyena is the most wonderful example of what I was saying. Much stronger, much faster than us. If she saw us on foot, she'd just disappear, she'd melt into the bush. So, look, Jamie is looking around, she's searching for tracks, she's listening, she's smelling, of course, but she's observing more from the vehicle, which means that her sense, her brain is not engaged in, ooh, what's around that bush? Ooh, what's around that tree stump? What kind of track is that? Where's the wind blowing? Because she doesn't have to be quite as aware in the car. It's a different kind of awareness. And on foot, yeah, it's much more of an active participation. Let's just wind our way around the back of the termite mound here and see if we can't spot that hyena. Otherwise, we'll carry on towards the north. Can I give you a hand up, yeah? You're right. I'm just going to hold the camera and give myself a little selfie while I answer Tina's question. Tina, you want to know if we're walking on animal paths or if we're just wandering about the place? We started off on an animal path, a hyena path, that's been made probably over the years, like you say, from the Gallagher waterhole up towards the den site. The den sites are often used again and again. But then if we find something interesting, so we came off the path to come look at this termite mound. There are a couple of holes in the termite mound where I think dwarf mongoose are trying to live. And so we did move off the path. And we're not walking anywhere near where I expected to walk this morning, but we've modified our route according to the alarm calls that we've heard and the different sort of tracks that we've seen. So it just depends, Tina. Depends entirely on what we see. Now, the hyena went walking through here. She will now know that we're around because she will have heard us. She won't have smelt us. The wind is still coming straight from in front of us, which is ideal. So let's just walk through here. There are two birds in there, Viam. I can't, just in that knob thorn there. You see them there? I think it's a plum-coloured starling. You see them? Let's move this way. There. It's not a plum-coloured starling. That's a little battus. No, it's a puffback shrike. And it makes a call that goes... You see it there? It's right in the open now. There we go. There we go. What's a puffback? I didn't see it very well. It looked very small to be a puffback there. Maybe it was a battis. You really can't confuse the two. It's appalling that I've confused them. There it is. Let me just, for my peace of mind, let me identify it. I can just see it moving in there. I don't know. Ooh, X rang a very nice question. Do I get the inspiration for my music from the sounds that I hear in the bush? And not so much the sounds, sometimes the sounds. It's definitely from the feeling of the bush though. That sound sounds like an angry buffalo. Just listen. Hyena. It's a hyena growling, groaning. Come, let's go look. I'm gonna walk very slowly down through here. Well, not so slowly, but very quietly. That hyena's probably found something to eat. Isn't that wonderful? Let's go and see if we can find her. She's gone down through here and up the other side. She's moving. Here you can see her tracks. They've come down through this drainage line here. Do you think we can get down there, or should we go around there? Okay, come, let's try and get through here. Like I say, Viem is carrying quite a lot of equipment, so it's not easy for him to just descend through here. Let me move that out of the way. There we go. It is very difficult. All right, let's try and get down. If it becomes difficult, we'll link to Jamie. There you go, Viem. We want to try and go up that path there. There we go. This is actually easier if I walk behind Viem, because I can keep the sticks out of the way. So if he tumbles down to the bottom of the drainage line, he won't fall on me. Yes, well done.